For this topic from a
conference will now be recorded.
Sorry about that. So our panel of experts are going to cover this topic from a variety of different scales, including some of them who will be speaking directly to the asset management technology that they use and how they use it at the county and the regional levels. So once again, my name is Dan Gold, and I am in Great Lakes Commission's IWAM project manager. And I'm also sitting here with my colleague, Ned Willig, who I'm working very closely with on this project. Before we get started, I'd like to go over just a few logistics. So we currently have the audience on mute, and we request that you stay muted for the panelist presentation portion of our webinar. We'll be holding questions until all three presentations are through, but in the meantime, please feel free to type your questions into the chat box as our presenters are speaking, and we will read them off at the end of the presentations. So about the final half hour of our 90-minute webinar today will be used for Q&A and open discussion. And at that time, we are going to invite you all to unmute yourselves if you'd like to join in on the conversation. And on a final administrative note, we'd love to fully capture our attendance and know who we're speaking with. So if you could comment your name and your work or your affiliation in the comment window below, that would be appreciated. So I'd like to turn to our agenda for today, and I'm going to begin by giving a very brief overview of the Great Lakes Commission's IWAM project, as well as some background as to why we're pursuing this project. Next, you're going to hear from our panelist presenters today, and today that's going to include Heather Himmelberger from the Southwest Environmental Finance Center, Jody Caldwell and Brian Wood from the Great Lakes Water Authority, and Steve Rozycki from Macomb County Public Works. Macomb County is in Michigan for those who are not familiar with Southeast Michigan. And then the final half hour, like I said, is going to be used for Q&A and open discussion, where we'll invite everyone to ask questions of our panelists or share your own ideas about the topics at hand. So a little bit of background. For those who don't know, the Great Lakes Commission is an interstate compact agency established under state and U.S. federal law that's dedicated to promoting a strong economy, healthy environment, and high quality of life for the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence region and its residents. The commission consists of governor's appointees, state legislators, agency officials from the 8 Great Lakes member states, and also the provinces of Ontario and Quebec have associate member status. So in 2017, along with partners from several member states and provinces, myself, Ned, and some other GLC staff set out to investigate the state of water infrastructure in the Great Lakes Basin and concluded that there's a significant regional investment gap that's projected to grow each year if nothing changes. Our findings are summarized in our Joint Action Plan for Clean Water Infrastructure and Services, and I invite everybody to go to our website or Google Clean Water Infrastructure Services and read that full report. And that action plan, it also included a series of recommended actions at various levels of government to mitigate this investment gap. So like I said, I invite you all to take a look at that action plan, but in short, our top recommendations called for increased regional coordination for water infrastructure asset management, as well as the need to comprehensively inventory and assess the current state of Great Lakes water infrastructure assets. The action plan was officially endorsed by the Great Lakes Commission in 2017, and we received some funding from the Joyce Foundation, which has allowed us to pursue this project. So right now, what we're calling it sort of phase one of the project, and there are several different components. So the first thing that we're doing in phase one is this webinar series, and you're all joining us for the third of our four webinars. And the fourth one is going to take place on May 1st, and we'll talk about that a little bit later at the end, but that fourth webinar is going to bring together this entire webinar series. We're going to hear from some leaders in Canada, Michigan, and Ohio, and we're going to hear about how they're planning to, or in some cases have already implemented, some form of state or provincial level integrated water asset management programs. So the first two webinars that we hosted last month are currently available on GLC's IWAM website. And this one is also being recorded and will be posted there in the next week. So the next thing, in addition to the webinar series, we're convening 2 to 3 in-person focus groups that are going to take place in May and June, where we're going to speak with specific communities and systems and try to learn about the barriers and opportunities and best practices for advancing IWAM on those local levels. And what's going to come out of all of this? Well, we're going to make a couple of reports. And the first one is going to be our phase one report that is going to summarize what we've learned through these webinars and focus groups and our literature review we're conducting and other interviews and networking that we've Ned and I have been undertaking over the last few months. So that phase one report is going to summarize those barriers, opportunities, and best practices. And we're also going to come up with a set of recommendations for how we can catalyze IWAM in the Great Lakes region. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to take those recommendations and we're going to make a work plan, which is also going to serve as a proposal for phase two, where we'll be looking for pilot communities in the Great Lakes region to implement our phase one recommendations. So by way of background, I'd like to just take a second, and I apologize to those who have been on this webinar before for because you've already heard this, but also I thank you so much for continuing to tune in. But what do we mean by integration? That would be the I in IWAM. And so we mean a couple of things by this. The first way that we mean is integration across traditionally siloed sectors. So that's going to include drinking water, wastewater, stormwater, green infrastructure. But taking it even further in the future, we believe that effective asset management and integrated asset management could also include other things like transportation, communication, and the energy sector. And that's just to name a few. The second way that we mean integrated is regionally and geographically. So we're investigating ways that local communities can better coordinate with each other at the county, the state and provincial, and even the national level to increase the effectiveness and efficiency of their asset management efforts. Going back to what I said earlier about the Great Lakes Commission being a regional and international organization, you can understand that we are well poised to help start conversations about how this can be done and to look for opportunities to share best practices and increase coordination of water infrastructure asset managers across the entire Great Lakes Basin. And so turning to the specific topic at hand today, which is technology and asset management, I'd like to just take a moment to say, to kind of go over some very basic bullet points that our presenters are going to expand upon as to why we chose to focus on technology as one of our four webinar topics. And so, my slides are a little bit out of order. Anyway, the first point that I would make is that has been said to me over and over again is that technology is not asset management. Technology is a tool which can help people with their asset management goals, but simply investing in software, having it, or even taking an inventory does not necessarily mean that you're doing asset management. It's kind of the first step just to understand how technology can be used and to acquire it. It's also become very apparent to me that there's no one-size-fits-all solution or software that works for everybody. You know, a large system might have an advanced GIS system and a smaller system might have a spreadsheet, you know, and even, you know, a book is old school technology. So maybe in a very small system, it even makes sense to, you know, to just do it the old school way and to have a log of maintenance and things like that. But the point is that there's a lot of different technologies out there for people to use, and the technology that a community invests in, it should be tailored to meet the needs of that community. And we feel that technology is an important way to upgrade from what's often called the million-dollar binder, where people have such a wealth of information about the history and state of their assets, but it might be sitting, you know, in a dusty binder on a shelf where that information is really kind of hard to access, or to summarize, or to do much with it. So we see that technology can make all the data and information much more accessible and usable for people. And I also think that technology can play a huge role in knowledge and information transfer. And that could be within an organization as, you know, people who have been maintaining systems for 30 years retire so that the information doesn't stay in their head, that the next generation has it at their fingertips. And also between different traditionally siloed sectors, like we talked about before. So my slides were out of order, but looking over to the left here, This diagram is the US EPA's five core questions for asset management. And I've been referring to this every webinar and kind of pointing towards which parts of this diagram we're focusing on. And you can make a case that technology could help with all five of these different core questions, but I've circled the three that I think it really focuses in on, where, you know, having technology and your information about your system and maintenance upgraded into a GIS technology or some kind of software, it can really help you assess quickly the current state of your assets. It can do more advanced modeling to look further into the future or model for things like climate change or things like that. And it can assess risk exposure in a way that would be much more difficult without using that technology. And in doing all of this, I think there's a big advantage of minimizing life cycle costs. If you can get a bigger picture of your system and make better decisions about where to allocate your funds to avoid something like a catastrophic failure, which would be much more expensive than routine maintenance. So that's sort of what I have to say about the role of technology in asset management, and our panelists have much more to say. So at this point, I would like to turn it over to our first presenter, Heather Himmelberger from the Southwest Environmental Finance Center, and her presentation, which has been titled Choosing Asset Management Software. So I can see your screen, Heather. Can't hear you yet. I don't know if you're still muted. We had your slides for a second there. Okay, we can see your slides now, but we still can't hear you. So maybe I can go through and unmute. Heather, I think you might have to unmute yourself using the icon in the GoToMeeting platform. So it looks like you just pinned in Heather, but you probably still have to hit the unmute button. So maybe we should go on to our second presenters, if we can kind of figure this out offline. So Jody and Bryon, do you guys want to take control? And we'll come back to Heather once we get this audio issue figured out.
Bryon, you are muted now as well. I believe you can unmute yourself, though.
Let's see. Maybe folks could... can everybody else hear Ned and I right now? I wonder if there's a larger issue. If anybody could just type in on the message chat to confirm that you can hear us. Okay, I see that you guys can hear us. And so who are we hearing now? Somebody's unmuted.
Yeah. I can hear you. This is Kazrak Great Lakes Water Authority.
Okay, great. So Bryon, we can see your screen.
Bryon, you are self-muted right now.
Hello?
Hey, Bryon?
No, this is Roger Willingham from Great Lakes. I can hear you as well on my end.
Okay. Well, I'm not sure what the issue is, but sorry about this, everyone. We'll just take a minute to figure this out. But if Bryon or Heather or Steve, if any of your guys' audio work, maybe you could chime in right now.
This is Steve. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah. Why don't we start with your presentation, and then we'll loop back to the other two. Does that work?
Fine with me.
Great. Thanks.
Okay, Dan, can you see my slides?
Yep, we can see it and we can hear you.
Great. I'm Steve Rozycki, wastewater engineer at Macomb County Public Works. Today I'm going to go through a little bit of the basics of our asset management program and kind of how Macomb County got to where we are today with it. So I'll start a little overview of the presentation, give a background of what Macomb County Public Works is. Kind of how we use our asset management plan to facilitate our needs, how the plan and our software were developed, as well as kind of how it's utilized across the variety of our staff members, and then wrap up with where we see our asset management software and asset management plan heading to in the future. So Macomb County, like Dan said before, located in Southeast Michigan, just a little brief background. It's the third largest county in the state and is just north of the city of Detroit. Public Works Office is separated into three main areas of concern, being wastewater services, stormwater, and soil erosion. As I mentioned, I'm a wastewater operations engineer, so this presentation is going to be geared more towards the wastewater side of things and how our field operators and how our staff use the asset management program for wastewater. In Macomb, we have two kind of separate but unique collection systems. Kind of show a map there on the right, where most of our system is a large tunnel collection system with community connections that drop in. We also have a small portion in the southeast corner of the county, which is a combined system. So it's a storm and sanitary water all in one system, and both outlet eventually to Detroit or to the Great Lakes Water Authority. So within our systems, we have a variety of critical assets, from pump stations, flow control devices, the physical collection system itself, all of which serve hundreds of thousands of residents here in Macomb County. All of this system is currently monitored by our SCADA software, which allows us to see everything that's going on throughout our collection systems. Since it is critical to keep these collection systems well maintained and operating at a high level of service to serve the residents, Macomb County saw the need for a quality asset management plan to help keep everything maintained and working properly, which also includes a strong asset management platform and keeping that well maintained. So at the county, we've utilized, I'll show a little bit kind of on our software. We use a program called NextGen to maintain our assets, but as Dan mentioned before, software is only a part of the asset management. It's a tool. It's not necessarily the entire asset management program. So kind of going into how we got to where we are in developing our program. So what did we want in an asset management program? And we wanted something that was easy to use across all aspects of our office, whether from our field operators, engineers, up to the management. So there's obviously a variety of user-friendly platforms that are out there, but Macomb emphasized, the desire to have something that can be used by everybody and well-maintained easily. The program that we use is very adaptive to our needs, which is something that, when picking and choosing a program, that's really what we wanted, is something that we can be customized. Although we utilize the software for wastewater services, this program has also been used for all types of asset management, including like large warehouses similar to what Amazon might be using. So this program that we're using for this, or the software, is very scalable from the small municipality to, like I said, something as large as like an Amazon-type warehouse. Although the core of the asset management program is very broad, they're very open to customizing to what our specific needs are for the county and for wastewater in general. The program continuously has updates. It's not once it's built, it is what it is. It's continuously moving with user-prompted updates, things that we see at the county we would like changed, as well as ongoing standard updates similar to how Microsoft updates your Office suite. And like most asset management programs, key features that we can use for it, preventative corrective maintenance, scheduling, our database for all of our asset information. Our GIS is completely integrated within our asset management system, so everything is linked spatially, as well as tracking hours, costs for doing work, and which all ties into building a budget for us for O&M and for capital improvement costs. So the background of where our asset management program started was through SAW grants. So the county, we were fortunate enough to have been awarded SAW grants for all of our drainage districts, which kind of led to the backbone of gathering all of the information that we have to build an asset management software or an asset management program. But like I said, that's just the backbone of it. It needs to be continuously moving. So with these SAW grants, they're able to go through all of our assets, inventory, provide life cycle information, replacement costs, the standard asset management information that we would need. But with that, though, the program needs to continuously evolve. As with any asset management platform, the program is only really as powerful as you make it or continue to build upon it. The backbone information from the SAW grants was great in getting this started, but it still needs to continuously move forward. So we treat our asset management software and asset management program almost as an asset itself. The asset management system needs to be continuously maintained and updated to provide all the critical information from our systems and make sure everything is up to date for engineers or for field operators or whoever is using this to continue moving forward. At the county here, we've got full-time staff that is focused on maintaining the asset management platform, GIS, and all the information that goes into that. One thing that we like to continuously do is have frequent meetings between our asset management development, our field staff, engineers, management, just to make sure all the information that we're collecting is updated within our asset management program. We think without this interaction between operators, support staff, and engineers, that the good asset management platform is going to be used to its fullest potential. Without that interaction, the program can potentially become obsolete quickly with aged information. Going back to what I was saying before about ease of use, that was a big thing for us at the county, is to make sure that everybody can use it that needs to use the program, from engineers, management, operators, and contractors. Engineering side, we use a lot for capital improvement planning, understanding what the current state of our system is, as well as future needs, and as well as looking through performance reports. What are the frequencies of preventative maintenance tasks or corrective maintenance, which can be used to see which assets may be failing sooner than later. Looking at costs to maintain the system. If an asset's continuously being worked on, obviously costs are high. It's time for asset replacement. And also we'll track different maintenance records as well as downtime for any assets. Can all be trended through this program. And then management will use that to look at how to budget for the next fiscal year. They'll look at useful life, when projects need to be done and what the capital costs of those are, as well as annual O&M costs, which include operator time. All of our operators and field staff go through and log their time for each project within the program, as well as the cost for any materials, contractors, anybody else that works on the system will all be built into this and trended for use for budgeting purposes. The operators are a primary user of this. They're out there in the field every day. I'll touch on that in a second with the a little bit about the tablets. And then contractors. We're currently developing a contractor portal within our asset management program, where if any preventative maintenance tasks need to be done that can't be done in-house, they will automatically be shipped out, the work order will be shipped out directly to the contractor. The contractor will then keep the work order from its generation through completion, where they can put in information for quotes, for part costs, for schedule, estimated time. They can update our O&M manuals, update any sort of drawings directly within our asset management software and attach everything to their work order before it's completed and closed out. Similarly with our field staff, you know, they use tablets out in the field. We've got tablets for all the field staff. They can go out and do their weekly, monthly inspections, work orders, whatever tasks are at hand, and have the full asset catalog in front of them. This shows photos, drawings, O&M manuals, as well as GIS information direct from the tablet, which I've got shown in the screen there. Things like photos are great to have on the tablet in the field so guys can actually see what they're looking for if they don't know what type of asset or what asset they may be maintaining that day. This also can provide them information for materials. We have a warehouse in our asset management program, where if they need a spare part, they can look up our inventory, see where we may have one. If it's at a different pump station, we don't need to order, we can have somebody go run and get a part on hand. So next few slides, I'm going to talk a little about kind of the future of what we see for our asset management plan. As I mentioned, I'm involved with mainly the wastewater side of things, but at the office, we do have the stormwater aspect. Looking at integrating all of our stormwater assets into our platform, along with the wastewater that are existing. And with the stormwater, we're looking for more of a public issue kind of hotline, I guess, which would be used for the public to notify our office if there's a problem out in the field somewhere that they can find with one of our drains. This public portal would allow the public to send a work order or send an issue into our office. The work order will then be distributed to the proper staff within our office where they can then address the issue. And with this hotline portal, you'll be able to, as the public, view and see the status of the complaint or the issue from when it was noted through the work being done and a final completion status of it. So it'll be all available for public information to see how the project progresses and when it's addressed. The other part of, community outreach that we're doing is other municipalities around us. So as Dan mentioned, they're looking at, working together with people in the Great Lakes area. The Southeast Macomb Sanitary District is another agency that is a neighbor to us, which has similar assets to what we have for our wastewater system. So at the county, we've reached out to them, and we're working with getting their assets into our database, hosting it on our servers for them to use, and then they can proceed with their asset management program through our software. Similarly, we're going to begin reaching out to any communities that their flows into our system, which they can then add in their asset management program within our platform already. And as I mentioned, what we have is very scalable, so some of the small communities may not have the large volume of assets that we have at the county, but all of this can be customized to their needs. And the goal of integrating with communities or other agencies is to obviously reduce cost on the overall maintenance of the asset management program. The other thing that we're working on building into our program right now is placing these QR tags or those barcodes on our assets, where field operators or whoever may be out there with a tablet, if they don't know what the asset that they're looking at is or want to look up further information, can quickly scan the QR code and pull up all the asset information direct on their tablet out in the field. Photos of the asset, any sort of historical photos that we may have in our database, bring up the O&M manuals direct on site, vendors, vendor contact information, as well as replacement parts, where they can get them, how long it takes to get them, and pull in the full preventative maintenance schedule from the history of the asset, from when it was installed, all the maintenance records, service records, anything else that we have attached in our database can be pulled up direct from there. And the final thing that we see for the future with this is integrating BIM or SCADA integration with our asset management program. So we have currently have some BIM or 3D models of our facilities that we're going to integrate direct into SCADA, where it's a very interactive feature for operators or engineers. It allows staff to three-dimensionally view what our facilities are, what they're looking for. Staff able to navigate through an asset, be able to click directly on assets within our facility and pull up that same information that they were able to with their tablet using the QR codes. The benefit of this is you can actually see kind of how the assets are put together, how the collection system runs as a whole, as well as view remotely. So this can be viewed from anywhere, even if you're not on site working on the asset. This will also be integrated directly with our SCADA system. So as our assets have alarms or have issues with them, they can be flagged, whether it's an alarm or an error or an asset flashing that there's something going on there, where the operators can then go through the model, 3D model directly and see what's going on. And this will all be built in with analytics within our software system where pump runtime, if something needs to happen after so many running hours, or if there's vibration alarms, whatever pops up, the operator will be able to fly through the 3D model and see what's going on and where the asset's located at. So with that, that's a quick overview of where we were with our asset management, how we got there, and where we see us going in the future. So if there's any questions, feel free to email me, or you can give me a call on my phone there on the slide.
Great, thanks a lot, Steve. And we did have one question. Just real quick, the question was, does Next Gen include vertical assets?
Yes. Yep. It includes all vertical horizontal assets, anything that we have in our system, including our SCADA assets, which may not be, I guess, classified vertical or horizontal assets.
Okay, great. And I do see other questions, but we'll hold them until the end. I just broke my own rule there. I think we've got our audio issues solved. So, Heather, are you able to share your slides?
Can you hear me?
We can.
All right, there we go. Okay, so let me just get the presentation up and running, figure out why. Hold on here. Okay. And then there's always hassles. Let me see. Okay, so are we seeing, looks like you're seeing my slides now. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, and you're hearing me, so all is good. It's sort of ironic that we're having a webinar about technology and technology is not working the way we'd like. So maybe that's a metaphor for our discussions today. So welcome everybody to today's webinar, and I'm really happy to be here. Asset management is a huge passion of mine, and I've been working in this area for over 15 years with water, wastewater, stormwater, and we're actually looking at a new project we just kicked off that will blend green infrastructure in with the gray infrastructure. So maybe in the future, because it sounds like you guys are going in the same direction, we can have further discussions about that. But today's particular topic is choosing asset management software and looking at how technologies fit in. And a little bit of this will repeat what you heard earlier, but there's no reason not to really hammer this point because it's a really critical one, that the asset management program is above all else a thought process. So we think about, you know, what assets we own, what are the assets that make up our system, what do we want the assets to do, which ones are critical to doing that, how we're going to intervene in the life of the assets from their beginning to their end. So what operation, maintenance, repair, rehabilitation, replacement activities are we going to do? And then how are we going to pay for it? So on the left-hand side, you kind of see this thought process in more of a linear fashion. And on the right-hand side, you see an icon that shows it more of a circle. And that's really how it is in practice. Everything interconnects, all of these different parts of asset management, these five core concepts, integrate and are completely intertwined, and it's circular. You never kind of are finished, and you don't really have a zero starting place because you're already doing some asset management activities, whether you call it that or not. So you kind of just jump in wherever you are, you know, integrate asset management into how you do business, and then it just becomes, you know, something you do all the time. So it's much more of a journey than a destination. So the most important thing to know is that any kind of technology or software that you choose to use is a tool that helps you with asset management and is not asset management itself. And it's so important to remember that you're not buying something that you will just say, okay, great, I got that asset management thing done now that I bought this piece of software. It's not like that, because the asset management, again, is a thought process. You still have to be an integral piece of that. And then you can use tools, whatever kinds of technology or software tools that you feel will help you to integrate into your asset management program. But you just need to keep that distinction that it's something that helps you. It is not by itself asset management. And the software or technology can be used for many different parts of asset management. It's great at storing data, sorting data, analyzing data, providing reports. And because asset management is really built on the concept of having data-driven decisions and making better decisions because you have more information, the technologies and the softwares can really help you because they will give you a better way to store that information, a better way to retrieve it, an easier way. Because many utilities that I go into have lots and lots of information. There are resources all over the place, but they're in a book over here, and they're in tablets over there, and they're in somebody's head. So there's a lot of information, but it's not in a really usable fashion. So technology can really step in there to help you. So you might ask yourself, does your utility need any software at all? Is that really an important thing, or can you just go on like you were? So a couple of things you might want to think about, you know, how complex is your system? Do you have a lot of staff? Do you have a lot of assets? And the more complex, the more assets, the more staff you have, the more the technology can help you, because it's going to get harder and harder and harder to keep things in your head, to interact with different people, to share information, the more complex you get. Thinking about record keeping, many utilities have pretty chaotic record keeping systems. You might have the same data in more than one place. It might be hard to find. And then thinking about knowledge management that was mentioned earlier, how well can you transfer knowledge from one person to another? And technology can really help in that regard. Thinking about your routine processes, how does the routine business work? Are you very reactive? Are you more proactive? Do things run smoothly and efficiently? How are your communication processes? Again, the more inefficient and the less smooth routine systems work or processes work in your system, the more technology might be able to help you. And then lastly, looking at some things about your spare parts inventory. This is an often overlooked piece of, you know, what we're doing. And I'm glad the previous speaker was talking about spare parts and mentioned some of those things about it, because it's often a forgotten piece of how much money you have tied up in your spare parts and how much that can disrupt normal business if you can't find your spare parts. You don't know if you have them, et cetera. So if that part of your system is not working very well, technology really can be helpful with spare parts inventory. So if you think about your overall operation, you can kind of decide how much technology you need. And you may not have to have a super sophisticated system. It might be less sophisticated, but you can kind of decide, you know, if technology could be a help for you. So because I've been doing asset management for so long, for years and years, one of the first questions I get asked is, what software should I buy? Or what's the best software? You know, some version of that question. And people are always disappointed because I say I can't answer that question. And they think I say that because I don't want to answer that question, that I don't want to make their lives easier, but that's not true. I can't answer that question because there isn't an answer to that question up front. There isn't one piece of software that's going to fit every single system out there. And if you think about the sheer magnitude of water infrastructure in the United States, there's about 65,000 community water systems. If you add in non-community water systems, we have about 150,000 total. And then if you throw in the wastewater utilities, it's, you know, somewhere around 60,000 of those. Then if you would throw in stormwater utilities, you got another, I don't know how many, tens of thousands of those. So you're talking about hundreds of thousands of utilities. There is no company, no matter how great they are, there is no company that could actually go out and design a software that would fit everybody. So it's really about finding the best software for you. And you can only answer that question by going through an analysis of your own needs and then looking at what software would be best for you. And you can't answer that question up front. One thing to keep in mind is softwares might be called different things. You might hear CMMS, computerized maintenance management system. You might hear asset management software. You might hear enterprise management software. So there's different names that they might go by. They do slightly different things, but for all intents and purposes, they're kind of all designed to handle data of utilities and serve some general functions like, you know, simplifying your data storage and retrieval, improving your organization and business practices, and the ultimate goal being to reduce costs and extend asset lifespans. There are a lot of potential functions that these programs can have, and there's not an all-exhaustive list, but the list on the screen has many of the things that they could have. Different softwares will have different pieces. Some are modular, where you buy, you know, so many of these functionalities, and then you can always add later a module to include some others. Some softwares only do certain functions. So it really depends on what you're looking for. You want to match your needs up to the functionalities that a particular software might be able to provide. So the most important question for you to start with is, what do you, as the person who's going to purchase and use the software, want to get out of the program? What's the most important thing for you? And it's really, really important to think through that, because you want a program that will do the thing that you're really after. You want to start with clearly defining your goals. What is it you're hoping to get out of it? Why are you going down this path? You know, what functions do you want the program to serve? You know, what's the most important out of that list of all the things it could have? You're probably not going to get all of that stuff, or you probably don't even want all of that stuff. So which pieces do you actually want? And then what functions might it need to talk to? So maybe you have a human resources program and you would like it to talk to that program. You know, can it do that? Or you have a billing software or your GIS system. Sometimes the softwares work directly with GIS programs. Some of them require GIS and will not function without it, like an Esri GIS platform behind it. So you kind of have to look at, are you integrating with something? Are you tying to something? You know, what functions do you want to connect to, and what do you want to have directly? You want to distinguish between the things that are, you absolutely have to have it or the program won't meet your needs, and what would be nice to have. And it's really important to think through that, because you want the program you buy to excel in the areas that you feel are must-haves. And if they don't have the things that are nice to have, maybe, you know, that's okay. Or you can look for a software that does pretty well at the must-haves and has a couple of your nice-to-haves. But really think through, which ones do I absolutely have to have? Which would be nice to have? And then think about how much field information or field devices do you want to include. Some work better with field devices than others. It depends on the design of the software. But most do have some capability of using smartphones or tablets or a particular device that's unique to that software. They might integrate with your GIS system that's a field type system. So think about what type of integration you want. And somebody typed in a question about, you know, will these tablets and things work in an offline setting? And we'll get to the bigger answer to that question later. But one thing I wanted to mention is sometimes they do and sometimes they don't work in offline. And if that's an important feature, make sure you check it out. I've had a couple of folks I've been working with that are really upset when they go out in the field and they try to enter something in a tablet, they lose connectivity, and then they have to start all over again when the connectivity comes back. So if it's important to you to work in an offline mode, make sure you check that out as you're looking through the softwares to ask that question to see how it will function. Think about what you can afford to pay for the program. All of the softwares charge differently. It may be based on the number of users of the software. It may be based on the size of the system. Some of them have a higher initial cost and then a lower per yearly fee. Some of them have lower initial cost but a higher yearly fee. Some have, you know, just an initial cost. Some have both initial costs and yearly fees. So they're all very, very different. So think about how much you can afford to pay right away and how much can you afford to pay every year. You know, will the program have to be customized for your facility or can you use it right out of the box? There are different programs that work one way or another. And then how much training is actually going to be required? And make sure you budget for it. You want to have your folks trained because otherwise it's not going to do you a whole lot of good if you go down the path of the software but nobody knows how to use it. Who do you want to be able to use the program? So do you want operators to have it, elected leaders, managers? You know, who are the people that have read access, write access? Do you want to put password protections? You know, how important is that to you? That's another thing to look for in your software. Do you want to have it located on your particular server or do you want it in the cloud? That's another very important question because many softwares are moving to cloud-based. And you'll find that some softwares will not work at all if it's not in the cloud. So if you really have to have it on premises and on your server, there are certain programs that you probably can't buy because they only work in the cloud. So really think through that. There are pros and cons either way. But it's something that you need to answer for yourself because that will influence the choice that you make going down the road. Once you get to the point where you're ready to kind of choose software and you've maybe looked at a couple or maybe you've talked to some colleagues and they've said we have this software or that software, set up demos. Call the companies up, ask them if you could have a demo, tell them what features you're looking for so that they can better prepare for the demo, and then think about the functionalities you want. So as you're watching the demo, do you think it's user-friendly? Do you think it's going to provide what you want? Would your operators be able to use it? Ask questions, ask lots of them, because the more prepared you come for your demo, the more you're going to get out of it. And I can't advise you enough to really get that demo, really look at the software so you know what you're getting into. And then who should you involve in discussing your software needs, the type of software you want to buy, what it should do? Everyone. Involve as many people as you can, because you want to know everybody's concerns, everybody's strengths and weaknesses, because that will help you in picking the software. So you may have like a committee if you have multiple staff members, but even that committee should reach out to others and make sure you're hearing from everybody so that you're getting the best software. Consider using a request for proposal process or something similar so that you can actually get, you know, different companies to bid on what you want so that you are looking at multiple choices and haven't just picked one without really thinking through it. And make sure that the RFP matches the needs that you're after as carefully and clearly as possible. So companies know what you want and you're basing your selection process on the things that you really have to have and how you want it to work. There are some challenges. One thing you want to make sure you have put in the time up front to make sure you're picking the right program for you. Most asset management failures are due to the lack of research and lack of ownership, lack of putting in that time up front. And I have had many, many people tell me, well, the software doesn't work. It's not that the software doesn't work. It's that you chose the wrong software for your particular installation. So many people will go out and just buy something and then try to fit their program, their asset management activities to the software. You really want the software to fit into your asset management program. So really think about it because you don't want to have the situation where you've purchased something and you decide you don't want to use it anymore and you're going to have to go buy something else because it'll cost you a lot of time, a lot of expense, a lot of trouble, and it will lose some credibility within your organization. So the more you think through the technology up front, the better off you will be. So my final thought is, if you put in the effort up front, you will be on the right track with your asset management software, and you'll get something that will work for you. But always remember, it's only a tool to help you. It is not asset management. So it will do what it can do, and then use those features to help you with your program going forward. So with that, I will turn it back over, and thank you for the opportunity to talk about asset management today.
Great. Thank you so much, Heather. And so now I think we'll be ready for Bryon and Jody from the Great Lakes Water Authority.
Yeah, can you guys hear us now? This is Jody Caldwell.
We can hear you.
Hello, everyone. Can you see the presentation?
We can. We're good to go.
All right. Great. Thank you for having us on this panel of discussions. There's a lot of good information that we're getting from this as well, and hopefully the folks online are receiving that as well. I want to apologize. I have a cold. You may hear sniffles and cough here, but Dan said the show must go on, so we're moving forward. We're here. I'm Jody Caldwell. I'm Asset Management Director for the Great Lakes Water Authority. I'm going to be presenting a few slides, and then I'm going to turn it over to Bryon Wood, Great Lakes Water Authority Manager of Enterprise Asset Management Systems as well. So it's a two-part presentation here. So just to give you a little background of Great Lakes Water Authority, Great Lakes Water Authority began operation on January 1st, 2016, and it was the result of a bifurcation from the City of Detroit. And the Great Lakes Water Authority really controls, operates, and maintains the regional infrastructure for the water and wastewater systems in Southeast Michigan. And you know, below on this slide, it shows, you know, we're very asset intensive organization, very dispersed geographically, and large assets. We have 5 water treatment plants, 803 miles of transmission main, 3 water intakes, 19 booster pump stations, and then on the wastewater side, we have the largest single site wastewater treatment facility in the US, 3 interceptors, 8 CSO basins, 9 pump stations, 181 miles of trunk sewers and interceptors. And just to show that geographically, you can see here, there's a water service area and a wastewater service area. The water service area covers 1,069 square miles, and the wastewater service area is 981 square miles. So we took a slightly different approach to our presentation here, and we wanted to step back a little bit from the technology, because how we look at it here at Great Lakes Water Authority is we look at the people, the process, and apply the technology to it. So I'm going to take a minute to talk about the people and the process that we have in place, and then I'm going to turn it over to Bryon for the technology. So from a people side, we're a large organization. We're close to 1,000 team members currently. And as I mentioned, we began operations January 1st, 2016. And at that point, I mean, the DWSD organization had went through several significant changes, reorganization and job redesign, the City of Detroit bankruptcy, and then ultimately the transition to GLWA. So the team members here have been through a lot and have seen a lot in the last decade. In addition, when we originally began as GLWA, there was a new planning services area that's a centralized service function to support the business units that are tasked with providing water of unquestionable quality. And so it's a brand new enterprise asset management group that I'm a part of, and my team members are a part of. We have multiple plant locations and facilities, limited time and competing resources, and challenges with the configuration of our enterprise asset management system. So our existing system currently is Oracle WAM. that was implemented 2012, I believe, around that time frame. And so there were challenges with that configuration, and that's something we'll address here later. I would assume that many on the phone call may smile when they see the last three, because I think a lot of folks have those same challenges. So to begin, you know, we saw there's a lot of great people within the organization doing asset management functions, and a lot of them weren't coordinated, and some were more mature than others, and some were using the CMMS system differently than others. And one of the first things that we implemented was what we call an asset management strategic organization. You could see it here, and it's basically a team of teams, and the satellite teams that make up this organization are cross-functional group from across the organization. The leadership team, asset management leadership team, provides strategic guidance for asset management. So this helps provide the direction, resources, support of the folks doing the work at the satellite levels. Just want to mention that 5 out of our 11, you know, executive leadership team members are part of this group. So we have executive sponsorship here as well. Asset management planning team, they develop the standards for how GLWA manage the assets across the organization, help to formulate individual asset management plans in this particular team. Asset management services team, they provide really central services for AMSO. They provide and document standard business processes, best practices, training, and communication across the organization. We have a GIS governance team that provide the guidance for the use and maintenance of our geographic information system, and a similar WAM governance team. Again, this is our CMMS system. They provide that guidance and coordination. So with its implementation, you know, we see some general successes. We have now interdepartmental collaboration across functions that typically weren't involved in asset management, you know, engineering, finance, public affairs, organizational development. We widen the scope of asset management initiatives across the organization. Created a monthly forum for developing new ideas and improve accountability. So these groups meet once a month or more frequently, depending on subtasks that are involved, and actually perform those tasks and report back out to ensure that they meet the project charter. Increased senior executive involvement in asset management initiatives. Again, I indicated, you know, 5 out of the 11 executives participate actively in this. Increased involvement from O&M staff. So again, we get a cross-functional group of team members and planners from across the organization that come together and have a forum for this planning. Improve asset management related communications and training opportunities. And then finally, you know, this governance structure, it allows us to help manage major project initiatives that come along. One of them I'm going to talk about, another one Bryon's going to talk about. The one I'm going to talk about is the strategic asset management plan that's currently underway. And then the other piece that's currently underway is the implementation of a new enterprise asset management system. So we're going to use the same governance structure. We have the people in place now to be able to govern and manage those projects moving forward. So now to the process. So in developing that governance structure, you know, we clearly saw that there may have been a lack of what we call line of sight between the frontline staff and what the organizational strategy is related to asset management. And that gap we identified was, you know, having an asset management policy and having a strategic asset management plan that has the buy-in across the organization and sets the ground rules and the framework so that we can develop individual asset management plans, so that we can implement certain technologies to help support those asset management plans as well. So where we're currently at with the strategic asset management plan is step number three, really the January to July step. But where we've come from, we've in order to identify a baseline of our maturity, we performed an asset management assessment. And it looked at, you know, our current technology, our current data, business process, and so on. And so it allowed us to get a baseline, allow us to kind of understand our priorities. We know that, and I think Heather had mentioned this in her presentation, that getting many people involved in the organization for major initiatives like this is an absolute essential for the success of these projects. So we spent time planning the teams that are going to help to develop this strategic asset management plan and develop the schedule. We kept the schedule relatively short. We didn't want this to be a long-lasting initiative throughout the organization. We wanted to get people's input and do this over a six-month period. We're currently in the process of developing, you know, the policy, the strategy, service levels, all the things you see under section three there. And, you know, the most important thing that I see out of that is identifying the asset management roadmap and implementation plans. We all have expectations on, in our individual areas, of things that we need to see improve, but we all need to come together and look at the global prioritization of those individual tasks or projects. And so, you know, that's gonna be very important for us. And then come July, August of this year, you know, we're gonna start working, updating our individual water and wastewater asset management plans and start working on those improvement initiatives that were identified. So asset management for us, and I think for everyone, it's a journey. And we want to take the journey to world-class asset management, and we've taken the first step to assess and to develop the strategic asset management plan, use the ISO 5000 framework, plan, do, check, act, work on our improvement initiatives, reassess, and then do the same thing. And as we move through time, we'll see performance improve, you know, those technologies will improve, and we'll manage our folks' expectations on where we're going next. So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Bryon.
Good morning, everyone. I wanna talk a little bit about how technology should support the people in the process. And at GLWA, we like to look at technology in that way, that it's really there. It wouldn't be there if it wasn't for the people in the process and the services that we provide. We also like to think about managing these asset management systems as you would an asset, like a physical asset, where you have to perform routine maintenance over time, and then you look at the costs and you decide whether or not to replace that asset at some time. We'd like to do the same thing with our systems. As Jody mentioned, we're currently using Oracle's work and asset management system. As you mentioned, there were some initial sort of configuration things that weren't initially set up, and really the root cause of that we found is really that we didn't have processes in place to support the people using it. That includes how do you do work in the system, and that is something we're looking to improve in the next generation system we're moving towards. So right now where we stand with our process of getting a new system is we're currently in the stage of developing new system requirements. And as we're doing that, we're enhancing our current system in support of that new system by going through and collecting or doing improvements. We are just releasing a SCADA integration with our Oracle WAM system. We can use a lot of that integration work that we did in our new system as well. We're also focusing on improving data that will translate over to the new system. So trying to spend time improving the things that really will benefit us most in the next system. And then in about 6 to 9 months here, we will select a new system, work to bring over the data, configure that system. I'll talk about a little bit more about that and how we intend to do that next. But we'll need to integrate with a few systems as well that currently don't have integration, including our finance system, to a higher degree of integration, as well as our Esri GIS data. And then kind of completing the cycle into the next system, we're going to make sure we spend more time thinking about how we support, improve, and train the users of the new asset management system. So the consultant that we have on board to help us with kind of the development of the requirements, they're helping us walk through what are the typical best practices used, what are the needs of our organization. We're going through and developing business process, high-level business processes so that we can actually configure the system around those. We're having workshops on all the different topics and needs out of the system and developing these processes that we can get a comprehensive system design, which another way to think about that is a sort of a specification, almost like a construction specification, but for the software. And that way we can make sure those processes are built into the software, the technology when we get there. This is all being sort of governed and led by the strategic asset management plan that Jody talked about, and the AMSO and IT governance we have in place to make sure that we are moving together as one team across the organization. So kind of how this looks, if we look at the people and the process, the technology together, is that they kind of all inform each other. The strategic goals set by the strategic asset management system and the organization overall will feed into the high-level functional needs of the enterprise asset management system. Things like, do we need to start procurement within the enterprise asset management system or in the finance system? And then how is that data kind of fed back and forth between those systems? The business processes are really where the requirements come from for the software, and the people are integrated to technology through those processes. And so the people are the ones, you know, the users are the ones making decisions day to day and interacting with the system. And we want to make sure that we connect all these pieces together as we implement our next system. There's kind of a saying that people come before process, before technology, and that definitely holds true. It's something we kind of learned from the last iteration of our system. We want to make sure this time we look at how the people in different roles interact with the process, and then that really informs what we need to do in the software. And so this is just a kind of a generic example, but we're developing these for work orders and a lot of other functionality, inventory, and things like that for our new system. So Heather talked a bit about this, so I won't spend too much time, but you really want to think about what your primary needs are out of the system, where you want to interface the system with. Make sure those systems also will support that interface so that the data can flow back and forth. Really, the kind of the whole point of having this information is the data, having reporting, you know, and decision making based off of that data. And making sure that the training and support mechanisms are in place for when you roll it out. We actually plan to bring in a lot of our kind of power users, I would say, of the software throughout the integration, or sorry, the implementation phase of the project. And that way, when it's rolled out to everybody, we've kind of already trained the trainers in that respect. Well, it's not just an IT project. It's going to be involved, you know, the entire organization in getting that buy-in. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail on these causes, but I'll just highlight a few of them. The first one's important. I think with every new system, everybody expects the perfection right out of the gate. Sometimes we make decisions to not complete all the integrations at once and kind of do it in a phased approach. Sometimes, you know, we often like to think, well, the next one's going to be perfect and we're not going to need to do a lot of hard work to get it up and running. And that's just not true with any of these systems. So it kind of takes work from everybody. And then also the staff resistance to change new systems. Sometimes we like to glorify the old systems. You remember when we had that old system and it worked great? just because it's a different system with a different interface, perhaps. But if we all work through it together and build those linkages between the old and new systems, and having those processes in place are going to be key. The next slide is about things, the kind of the opposite of the previous slide, and what you can do to have success when implementing new software. Really, you want to understand kind of what it's going to cost, how you're going to bring the data over from the old system if you have one, or if they're from spreadsheets or whatever. get the staff buy-in all along the process, make sure that you have your inventory of assets ready to go as you implement the system. So those are just some thoughts. As you'll notice, between the potential causes of failure and success, 80 to 90% of them are about the people, and that kind of where it starts and should be focused on. And the processes then should kind of lead to the technology. Some highlights of things that we're currently doing with our existing system. We are now doing some KPI reporting using Power BI primarily, and these go to our board to show kind of the work, the output. So this is examples of some of the decisions or reporting that we may want to look at from our EAM system. And again, that can drive what type of data we need to collect, as well as what to look at in terms of performance over time now that we have this data available to us. We also are working on many improvements to GIS. We are putting out tablet-based information or collection, information collection tools. This is one of them for our hydrants. And so we can go through and click on a hydrant, select some and enter some data in terms of the condition and status of that hydrant. And the GIS team has also built a dashboard that you can look at kind of really quickly and see the condition and any of the issues from those inspections that were done in the field. And then also we want to make a note about regional collaboration and what we're doing there. Currently, we have a few different initiatives going on in terms of collaborating with our member partner communities. We have a capital improvement plan viewer, which is a GIS-based viewer that you can get to online that will allow any user to see the details of our capital improvement projects that are identified or in progress. We are working on GIS data sharing agreements with some of our member partners to share data back and forth for further collaboration. And then the Michigan State 21st Century Infrastructure Commission pilot we participated in, and we're tracking that ongoing and participating as we can, so that we can start to look at that infrastructure overlap between transportation and other utilities as well. So in summary, where we're going with technology is we're trying to support the people, optimize their workflows so that they're spending less time working with the system and more time getting work done, but also making that available hopefully more on a mobile basis in the future, allowing them to get to that data when they need to see it. And so we just want to make sure we're linking together all our processes closely with our technology and our people to do that. So with that, thank you for your time.
Great. Thank you, Jody, and thank you, Bryon. And thank you to all of our panelists. Those were really great presentations. I really appreciate your contribution to this project. There's one question that was typed in that I will get to first. And after that, Ned has one question to kind of start off the panelist talk. And then after that, we'll open it up to the audience and see if anybody else would like to ask a question or contribute their own experiences with technology and IWAM. So the question that came in, this came in during your presentation, Steve, and it's, does next-gen software on tablet work in offline mode, meaning when there's no internet connection?
First, can you hear me?
Yep.
Okay. Yes, it does. So there's a caching feature with it, which kind of goes two ways. Kind of use an example. If we've got work going on in the basement of our pump station where there's no internet or wireless cell service down there, you can download any information direct to the tablet from our software, whether it's O&M manuals or any other information from the work order that you want, and bring it with you. As well as when you're down there, you know, working on the asset, you can fill out your inspections, fill out your forms, fill out your preventative maintenance forms on the tablet. And then when internet or cell reception is returned, the caching feature will then input all of that into the software. So yes, it's completely workable offline.
Great, thanks. Great. So one of the questions we wanted to start off, and I think most of you touched on it in
several different ways on the call, but I want to ask each speaker, for your organization and for the work that you do, what are some ways that you measure or define the success in terms of your asset management planning? And then with that, are there some ways that the technology and software that you guys are using has better helped you think of new ways to measure or define success or develop different indicators of success? So maybe we can start with Steve again and then go to Heather and then the GLWA folks.
So I guess our biggest measure of success, I guess, in my mind is making sure that all of our systems are running. I mean, if these critical assets that we have, as well as, you know, similar to Great Lakes, serve either millions or hundreds of thousands of people. So if our assets can be maintained properly and on time, I guess that's our biggest thing of success. So with tying that to asset management, you know, making sure all the preventative tasks are up to date, making sure all of the corrective maintenance that needs to be done gets done in a timely fashion is really what is successful. And I think what we do to kind of keep that moving along or keep everything up to date, as I mentioned before in the presentation, was constantly getting feedback from the guys in the field to the engineers, to the management. That way we can, you know, when an issue arises, we can get budget, we can get funding, we can get time scheduled, kind of keeping everything organized and maintained on time. And then I guess the second part of your question for new ways to keep things working, I kind of touched with the presentation too about what we see this going to in the future with integrating into the 3D models into SCADA. That will, I think, significantly cut down on the response time. If you can see instantly on a screen, you know, what an issue is, when it arises, and then how to get at it and fix it in a timely manner. That is, to me, a very successful approach to the asset management.
Thanks, Steve. Heather, on you.
Yeah, I'll speak about it from a slightly different standpoint, since we're not a water utility ourselves, but we work with water and wastewater entities, I just wanted to talk a little bit about some entities we worked with and how they have used asset management from our software and asset management to help them. So one particular organization had a lot of data about pipe breaks, but it was in a format that didn't do anybody any good. There was one person who knew how to use the Access database, and even then didn't know what all the different features of the Access database were. Some of the codes we could never figure out what they were. So there was about 15 years worth of data, but it wasn't spatial. It wasn't in a format that could actually help them make any decisions. So it was trying to take that data from a format that wasn't very useful to put it in more of an asset management technology setting and get that data into GIS so that it could then make some spatial decisions on it. And what the data showed is that, you know, as is typical for most systems, pipe breaks are not kind of randomly scattered throughout the system. They tend to be clustered in certain areas where maybe soils or different factors cause the pipes to decay in a different fashion. So they were able to show that even though all this pipe in one area was put in at exactly the same time, it's all about the same size and type of pipe. There were two pipes that had significantly more breaks than the others, so that it really reduced their replacement program from, I guess we have to do all of this because it's all the same age and we don't really know what's going on, to, hey, there's two pipes here that we can replace. So when you bring technology into the picture to handle the data in a better way, it can really, really help you. So many, many times we go into utilities and there's lots and lots of data that's stored here and stored there. And it's, you know, somebody's head and it's on this logbook and it's in this file cabinet. And the data is great, but it's not usable in its current format. So one of the biggest things technology can do is take that data that you have that's not very usable and provide it to you in a way that you can sort it and filter it and analyze it so that it is usable for you. So even things like, you know, how much energy do your pumps use and things like that, the more you can find technologies to help you, the more you can start making better decisions going forward. So, you know, when you have complex systems with lots of assets having a better way to store that data to help you think through better decisions can really, really be helpful.
Great, thanks, Heather. Bryon and Jody?
Yeah, I think some of the ways to measure or define asset management or to define success in asset management planning, I think our, you know, Bryon showed some key performance indicators. Monthly, we provide our board of directors the key performance indicators, and we have targets associated with them. And so that's one way to ensure that we're performing asset management functions to meet those targets. However, you know, we are going through this process, and in the process of developing a strategic asset management plan, we're looking at kind of these global service levels and service level objectives, and then looking at individual performance indicators that could meet those service level objectives. So key performance indicators are things that the boards are interested in, but these other performance indicators may be other things that individual business units are need to improve their operation or to ensure that they're completing their PMs or their seat or their corrective maintenance work orders as well. And so I think Bryon and, you know, our team has pulled together a lot of good reports with Power BI, and Bryon can talk about that a little bit. But the other thing that we've done internally, we've had several town hall type meetings with various folks that use our CMMS system. Sometimes they're more negative than positive, but it's good to get feedback from folks to see where we need to improve and areas where we're doing pretty well. We also have with the AMSO governance structure, it allows them monthly to come back and provide feedback on individual projects that need to get done, individual areas that may need improvement. So I'll turn it to Bryon.
Yeah, the only thing I would add to what Jody said is in our next system, we are trying to look at reporting needs, what types of decisions and performance metrics do we want to get out of the system as KPIs, and kind of tying that together using the strategic asset management plan with the service levels, making sure the data being entered into the next system will support those reporting needs without a lot of manual effort like happens today.
Thank you, Bryon and Jody. That was great. And I would also say that if anyone else on the call, I know we have several people here that are very involved and key kind of thought leaders and experts in asset management. If you have anything that you'd like to contribute on ways that you think about success, we'd be very interested to hear those. And you feel free to either speak up or type in the chat box. In any way that works best for you. But Bryon and Jody, I want to have a follow-up. You mentioned town hall meetings, and I know one of the challenges that always arises with implementing different asset management plans and adopting new technologies is getting staff buy-in and having training for that. And I wonder if you could speak a little bit to that, and then also for the other two, for Heather and Steve, you guys all as well are involved in training. If you could speak a little bit to some of the different challenges and then ways that you've overcome or worked to kind of develop more of a culture of asset management within your organizations or within organizations that you work with.
Yeah, so this is Jody. I'll go ahead and start. You know, the town halls, the purpose of those are really to gauge and get a pulse of where our existing asset or CMMS system stood. You know, how well are we doing? What areas do we need improvement? Communication and training, you know, may have been brought up in those town hall meetings, but it wasn't a specific purpose for the meeting. We have through this strategic asset management planning process, training was an important issue for us to identify a common language, a common asset management language throughout the organization. So as part of the strategic asset management plan,
We've trained currently 25 people in the Institute of Asset Management training, 3-day training program. And then we trained 50, you know, team leads, planners, all the way up to chief folks in certified reliability leaders. We had 50 of those. We're going to do another session as well. And what we've already seen is in these meetings related to the strategic asset management plan development or with the EAM requirements gathering process, we're using the same terminology. We're speaking the same language. And I think what I see in a lot of these training programs that we're sending folks through is there's those aha moments. Oh, I thought asset management was just a CMMS system. I didn't think I had anything to do with asset management. And I'm speaking from a finance person, you know, or from an engineer. And so now they see specifically how their roles fit into the overall asset management function. So I don't know. Do you have anything else to add, Bryon?
Yeah, the only thing I would add is to reiterate, you know, when you are implementing a new system, don't wait till the end to do the training. Bring people along, even from the requirements gathering, to make sure that what they expect out of the new system is being asked for in the RFP or how you're selecting that software. And then also make sure that you train the trainers, get the people helping configure it, the system as you go. And that's really training them in that new system from the get-go.
So we have just a few minutes remaining. So I want to give Steve and Heather if you briefly want to share things, but we'll need to start wrapping up in about 2 minutes or so.
Okay, yeah, this is Steve. I agree a lot with what Jody and Bryon said, you know, making sure that you get proper training up front from the asset management development, as well as keeping all your staff, you know, involved through the process. I think that's key. For us, we meet with our asset management software developer pretty much annually. They come in and kind of show us new features, what's coming, as well as they have a conference every year for a few days where you can do more in-depth training, which is kind of our asset management manager. And then with the field staff too, you know, we've constantly been with everybody up front on what's being developed, what's coming. Obviously, it's a slow adoption of, you know, new systems, but we've worked with them from the beginning and shown, you know, what's going to happen, what the asset management program brings, what information they can access easily, to kind of, you know, lay out the benefits as we're rolling out the new program. And I think that was key, rather than just, you know, here's the full suite of everything and run with it now. It was kind of a slow adoption period, but it really showed what the power of a good asset management system is to everybody. And, you know, it's been adopted across the board of our staff members.
And I'll just add real quickly, this is Heather. I'll just add that it's really, really important to have training as part of the overall process, and not just assume that everybody's going to know magically what to do. So I think we really need to put that in our overall programs, you know, not just training the top level staff, but all the way down. And just as one quick example, I've been doing some training for the Albuquerque Bernalillo County Water Utility Authority for years now, and they train every employee who's going through the supervisory training, or their new onboarding employees. And there's like several different training programs that they have that are for other purposes, but they do a little blurb about asset management in every one of those trainings. So that over the years, I've trained pretty much everybody who has come through their system. And then they have, you know, some other internal trainings as well. But what I've noticed from the very first time I trained, and I'd say, how many of you know what asset management is and could describe it? And almost nobody, to the last training I did was a few months ago, and there was quite a few people there, about 40 people. And I asked them to describe in their own words asset management, and they really were spot on, and everybody knew the terminology, and everybody knew, you know, what asset management was about. So the more you can get that training embedded and keep it going, the more chance you have that people understand it, will adopt it, and you get that culture change.
Great. Thanks, Heather. And so we're at the top of the hour now. So I just once again want to thank everybody for tuning into this webinar. And I want to invite you all to join us for our fourth and final webinar That's going to be taking place on Wednesday, May 1st. And that one's titled IWAM Policy and Program Implementation. We're going to have people from Michigan, Ohio, and Ontario talking about those high-level asset management programs that have been implemented. I'm pretty excited to hear more about that. And sorry we didn't get a chance to have audience discussion, but please contact us if you want to continue this conversation. We want to network with pretty much anybody who is also interested in this. So please contact us, let us know your take on what we spoke about today in terms of technology and IWAM. If there's any good literature out there that has anything to do with asset management that you think that we should know about, please send that our way. Suggestions for other people we should be looking to partner with to further our IWAM goals, let us know. And finally, as I mentioned earlier, there is a phase two of this project in the works, where we'll be looking to take everything that we've learned and try to help some pilot communities further their own asset management goals. So if anybody comes to mind when I say that, give us a call and let us know. And otherwise, that's pretty much it. So,
and we wanted to give a big thank you to our speakers, Jody, Steve, Bryon, and Heather. We hope you guys, we appreciate your time today, and thank you for participating, and really got a lot from it. So with that, we want to say thank you very much, and have a nice day, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dan.
Yeah, all right, thanks everyone.
Good job, everybody.